morning, panel. May it please the court, I'm Tony Hill, representing the Democratic Party of Hawaii.
Mr. Hill, could you just pull up the microphone just a little bit?
Surely. Is this better?
You're unexpectedly tall for the podium. Thank you.
The district court in this open primary case ruled against us on two main theories. The first theory, which I will cover briefly, has now been essentially removed by the Patel case at the United States Supreme Court. And I'm going to suggest that the result of that case simply deletes that rationale completely.
Tell me why.
The Patel case is informative because the district court's first theory was that if one could plausibly suppose that there were a non-objecting political party or a political party that might embrace the open primary.
That doesn't, what you're saying is that the Supreme Court's made that clear, that doesn't excuse. The fact that somebody may accede to a constitutional violation doesn't mean that those who are hurt by it.
Quite so, quite so. And so the germane quote is one sentence or so, and it is, the proper focus of the constitutional inquiry is the group for whom the law is a restriction, not the group for whom the law is irrelevant.
So I tend to agree with you on that point. Let's move on to what I think may divide our circuit from other circuits, at least the fourth, and what I think is the problem in this case for your side. Our cases, particularly the Bayless case out of Arizona, seem to say that this is a factual
issue. Yes.
And that you've got to come forward with some evidence.
Yes. Well, you anticipate the flow.
You're making a facial challenge.
Well, before you get there though, you construe that Judge Seabright ruled that, that any facial challenge you made failed. Is that right?
Judge Seabright ruled the facial challenge failed, yes.
But I think he specifically said an as-applied challenge is open, right?
Yes, that is what he held.
It's not foreclosed. Now, what are you arguing today? Are you arguing a facial challenge?
I argued a facial challenge below and here.
Here. In other words, you're arguing today that Judge Seabright erred in holding that the facial challenge fails. Fails, right?
I'm arguing today, because of Patel, his...
Well, just on the second round.
On the second?
It failed on the second round as well as the first.
Correct.
All right, now you can get to it.
Yeah. That's my question. I'm Judge Seabright.
Right.
Nice.
Right. Yes.
I think in this circuit, the law is... convince me to the contrary, that when you're making the kind of claim you're making, that a primary system discriminates against someone, you must come forward with some evidence. And we all agree you didn't because you're making a facial challenge. Why doesn't your claim fail for that reason?
There are two models that the Ninth Circuit has proposed for looking at this kind of situation. One is the Bayless case, the other is the Reed.
Case is exactly the same case as the Supreme Court decides in Jones. So Reed, there's no distinction whatsoever from Jones and Reed.
And my argument is that the way Reed looked at it is the correct way to look at it.
That's my question. Reed is exactly the same case as Jones. So I'm not sure when you have exactly the same case as the Supreme Court has already decided that there's any factual inquiry that's permitted. Your case is not the same case as Jones, is it?
We contend that it is in all material respects.
A blanket system in Jones, yours is an open system, correct?
We contend that the open primary in Hawaii
okay, fair
is.
Enough. But didn't Bayless, doesn't, you contend that, but the Supreme Court's never decided that issue. And Bayless says that with respect to open primaries, we have to deal with facts, not just the legal argument. So you may be right. Other circuits disagree with the way we've approached it, but tell me how you get around Bayless.
I try to make these arguments to you, if I may be permitted.
Sure.
In the first case, Bayless leads inevitably to absurdities and confusion. and I will illustrate them in a moment. Bayless allows for peculiar results.
Let me ask you a question differently. Bayless may be really a dumb decision. I'm not sure it was, but I'll posit that for you. Let's assume it's a really dumb decision, but it's one of ours. It's one of our children. It's one of our children.
Yes.
Telling us that we're dumb really helps. So tell me, get around it for me, if you would.
Bayless leads to anomalous and confusing results because the same test, let's say same text, in alternate states could be constitutional in one and not constitutional in the other because Bayless inappropriately
focuses. But you're telling me why Bayless is wrong. Unfortunately, the three of us have to assume it's right.
Because Reed provides an alternate method that is actually more appropriate under the circumstances.
I think what you're saying is Reed and Bayless are in conflict.
They are indeed, sir.
Right, so, and we can't follow both.
That is correct.
And you're contending, well, how do we choose under your theory one over the other?
Because the similarities between the Hawaii Open primary and the Jones case are so profound and so striking, and the alleged differences between the open primary and the blanket primary are in essence negligible.
But wasn't Bayless was an open primary, correct? Libertarian Party of Arizona was an open primary.
Yeah, it's a variation.
A variation of an open primary, whereas Reed was a blanket primary.
Yes, Hawaii's...
Is it open?
Hawaii's is the purest example of an open primary you will find.
So what our precedent seems to tell us is that when you have a blanket primary, there are no fact questions. But when you have an open primary, there are fact questions. That's how I reconcile Reed and Jones. Tell me why I'm wrong.
Because Jones, although it did take...
Reed and Bayless, I'm sorry.
Well, another way of looking at it, Judge Roberts, is that under Jones... The Supreme Court went through an extensive record, you know, supported it by the findings made by the lower court. So I don't think you can say in that kind of primary, it's not a factual issue.
If you, and this is the important point for study, and this is why I'm here. If you look at the way Jones was actually decided, which is similar to the way Reed interpreted Jones as being decided, you will see that you do not find, we'll make up some finding, you don't find that Sanders won 42.6% with 1.9% crossover or any such thing. You don't find that. What you find is that the structure of the blanket primary law itself leads ineluctably to the conclusion that serious kinds of damage are possible. Possible. The only material facts that are of the fact-gathering type, the statistical fieldwork type, that matter in Jones are the proportion of members to the electorate, which they noted was basically one-half of the electorate. Well, in Hawaii, we have that trumped.
Well, you really don't, because you have a different system, and I wanted to ask you about that. In the other cases, we have states under which you register with the state as a Democrat or Republican.
Yes.
Or something else. Hawaii has no registration.
Correct.
And so I have no idea whether all the people who voted. What you're saying is that we're being bothered here because people who haven't joined the party organization as opposed to identified themselves as Democrats have associated themselves with us.
Yes.
That these people may be dyed-in-the-wool Democrats who don't care to join your organization. How do we know that you've actually been required to associate with bad guys, if you'll use my term?
Because a fortiori, our proportion is worse than in Jones and in the other
states. But it's really not when you look at the voting record of the state. The voting record of the state is overwhelmingly Democratic. What you have is a very small proportion of those people who vote Democratic who have joined your party organization. That's why the Hawaii case strikes me slightly different.
And I've got the same problem. It's hard for me to understand where the beef is. party controls about 90% of all the elected positions in Hawaii.
Because there would be a different Democratic Party. You'd have a
more
socialistic government, right?
It would be certainly different. Now, the difference between the Jones case and the Hawaii case is that two generations have passed in Hawaii under the new regime. In Jones, there was a closed primary for a long time, and they flipped it, so they were able to look at that contrast. But to follow the point just made, Hawaii has already acculturated itself, if you will, to the fact that anybody can walk into anything and vote however they want.
But I'm asking you a different
And they
question.
Have no right to do so, sir.
But I'm asking a different question. I understand your legal point. My problem is this. You had something like 290,000 people voting in the primary.
Yes.
And about...
Give or take.
Give or take. And you know the numbers and I don't. And what, about 60,000 or 90,000 people...
Depending on the year you pick.
Registered in the party.
Yes, sir.
If Hawaii said tomorrow you can't vote in primaries, we'll have an open primary, but you've got to register first as a party member. My guess is that the overwhelming number of those 290,000 people would register as Democrats.
That's an interesting guess.
And that, it is an interesting guess, and that's why the absence of a record troubles me, because what I've done, and I've done extra legal research, but I think I can take judicial notice of it, I've looked at election results in your state, and they're overwhelmingly Democratic, so some great number of those people who voted in your primary must identify themselves as Democrats, but just didn't bother to join the formal party. So deal with that for me.
One, there's no need. Two, footnote 5 in Jones is an important study here, because footnote 5 in Jones tells you flatly that people who do not join a party have no right, and in fact can hardly be considered to have an
interest. Footnote 5 in Jones deals with a formal state registration system.
Correct, and we don't even have one.
I know, and that's my problem. Since you don't have one, I'm not so clear why your associational rights have been. Surely it's not the associational rights of the private party, is it? Of the Democratic Party qua private party.
In order for there to be a meaningful political association of any sort anywhere, it is a public association because politics is public. What the Democratic Party says is we will take you if you believe generally with us and you're willing to be identified as such. If you are not willing to be identified as
such. Privately identified as such, not publicly.
This is the difference between being a citizen and buying a can of soup off the shelf. If I buy a can of soup off the shelf, it doesn't make me a shareholder at Campbell's. What you have to do is you have to look at what is the willingness of the person to be identified, to stand by the party, to work with the party.
Let's posit a slightly different system than Hawaii is.
Sure.
No party registration until the day of the primary. You have state registration on the day of the primary. You walk in and the state registrar says to you, what do you want to be, a Democrat or Republican? And you say Democrat, and you register on that day formally with the state of Hawaii, and then you vote. Okay.
It's okay as a transitional measure, but not as a long-term one.
It's okay as a constitutional measure. What if they want to keep it forever?
No.
Why does it violate the Constitution?
Because what it does is it prohibits the party from fully associating with that person in any meaningful way.
2 days before?
I think that the acceptable rule would be 30 to 90 days.
I'm having a hard time figuring out how are you going to associate with those people? What you want them to do is identify that they're with you, right?
No, you want to communicate with them and save the money on the election. Right now, you got to run to the whole electronic populace.
Your complaint here is forced association with people you don't want to associate with. That's your First Amendment complaint, right?
Yes.
What if these people say, on the day of the primary, I want to associate with you. I love you. You don't have forced association anymore.
You have a kind of a hybrid.
You can't reject them. You don't have any ability to say, I don't want you to be a Democrat.
That's right.
Donald Trump
under your hypothetical,
right,
that's
Donald
correct.
Trump shows up and wants to register as a Democrat.
Yes.
He can't, can he?
We don't. I don't advocate. Yes. The problem that you're projecting is one that I I don't want to be in that world. What we're looking for.
Well, I understand as a policy matter, you don't. But I'm trying to figure out what the difference is in First Amendment terms between somebody who registers the day before the primary as one of your folks and somebody who indicates that he wants to associate you by picking up the Democratic ballot. What's the difference?
There's no material difference between the day and the day of, but there is a material difference between a period maybe 30, 60, 90 days before and the day of.
Mr. Gill, you argued to Judge Seabright that it would be very difficult to adduce the kind of evidence that he thought was required in order to demonstrate the severity of the burden. And to follow up on Judge Hurwitz's questions, are you looking for some kind of a test that can be employed for people who want to join the Democratic Party in Hawaii in order to make sure that they adhere to certain fundamental precepts of the party platform before they are welcome into the party? And if so, how would you do that?
Normally what you do is you take an application which involves certain assertions about what you believe and that you're willing to be public.
Like a litmus test. If you adhere to 6 out of 10, then we'll accept you. But if it's 5 or below,
it could be, I suppose.
Never turned anybody down for membership in the Democratic Party of Hawaii.
It happens as an exception, but yes.
The record doesn't reflect that.
It does not.
Okay, but it's hard to join the Democratic Party in Hawaii.
It's not hard. It's not particularly hard. But remember, what we're looking at now is the fruits of 2 generations of the open primaries. There's simply no upside to joining. Why would you bother? If you felt, for example, that you ought to drop in on the Democratic Party and vote for their person, and you thought, I'm generally a Democrat, there'd be no upside for you to join because you get every benefit that's possible.
Is that the kind of person, so I'm generally a Democrat, I want to vote in a Democratic primary, is that the kind of person you're complaining about being associated with?
In a way, yes, because the right to determine who is the standard bearer is the province of the membership who believes in the party as an organization, not the ones who follow the guru of the day.
But you do agree that the state in other states can say, we're going to determine who is a member of the party, not by private joining of the party, but merely by asking you to register as a Democrat or Republican.
Yes. In Hawaii, before this current regime, there was, for a 10-year period, a registration requirement.
Right. And under your view, that doesn't violate your right to association, even if some of the people registering as Democrats are Republicans in disguise.
It's close enough. I mean, it's not ideal, but it's the way that it works, because under a registration system, you can't.
I flip back. Doesn't Mr. Hill? I thought there were statements made at the convention that the problem with that old system was that people were being retaliated against depending on which party they registered with, maybe in the sugar mill town or.
Yes, yeah. That is a reference to the plantation era in Hawaii, and people there understand that reference as such.
But how do you respond to the state's interest in trying to encourage more voter participation by protecting their privacy and not requiring them to declare a party?
Because they have 100% right to vote in the general, but if they do not feel able or willing to identify themselves publicly as Democrats, they are not part of the nomination electorate.
Hasn't the change in the Hawaii Constitution resulted in greater voter participation?
Not really. No. Voter participation, and this is not in the record, of course, but you can research it for yourself if you wish. Voter participation on the decline is a general phenomenon of all industrial democracies and is not sensitive particularly to the open or closed arrangement, which you can verify by looking that up.
So to get back to Judge Tashima's question, what you're really looking for is that even though we control, let's say, 90% of all the publicly elected offices in the state, we want a different kind of Democrat in those positions than the ones we have now.
that is a fair approximation of the position, and I think that if Ravalli were here, they would say the same thing from the other side of the fence.
We're not quite sure where Ravalli is at this point, but they're not here. You're down to 30 seconds. You want to save a little time for rebuttal, or do you want to?
A bit. Thank you.
Okay. All right. We'll hear from us.
Not as tall as opposing counsel. Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, Deputy Attorneys General Deirdre Marie Iha and Marissa Looning, for Scott Nago, Chief Election Officer of the State of Hawaii, appellee. Your Honor, my opponent's concession that Patel forecloses his argument about the nature of the facial challenge resolves this case in its entirety.
You do agree that other circuits have resolved these cases facially?
They have, Your Honor. The only cases where open primaries have been struck down have been as-applied challenges.
Well, but they've been upheld facially, haven't they?
Correct. They have, Your Honor.
Are you still pressing your Salerno argument?
I think in order for the court to resolve the facial challenge, you must apply a standard.
Well, no, I guess maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm characterizing it wrong. Judge Seabright, as I recall in your opponent, says ruled on two grounds.
He did, Your Honor.
One was that since the Republican Party was fine with it, then the Democratic Party couldn't complain. That's the...
In a nutshell, for a facial challenge, yes, Your Honor.
That can't be right, can it?
It can. In terms of the standard, I don't believe it's necessary for this court to decide between the...
So if I have a statute that's facially unconstitutional, then I can't complain if there's somebody out there who likes it.
It's the nature of the associational rights at issue that makes this happen in this case. And essentially, the reason this matters is because the party's interests can change. So you can see this in the history where the Republican Party in Connecticut was closed and then they wanted it open.
No, I understand that they can complain, that they're not foreclosed from complaining. But let's assume that your opponent's right in all respects here, that this is a plot by the Republicans to infect the Democratic Party spies and traitors. Of course the Republican Party would like it. The fact that they like it shouldn't foreclose a challenge to it.
It's not whether they like it for purposes of getting into the Democratic primary, Your Honor.
They don't oppose it.
No, Your Honor.
It hasn't been very effective.
Well, correct. It has not been very effective if that is their plot. The reason that the wishes of the smaller parties in Hawaii, and I include the Republicans in that number, matter is not because that's what they want. It's because it furthers their associational interests. We know that this is true because in the Klingman case, the Libertarian Party tried to open their voting to everyone, and Oklahoma had semi-closed, and the court said that was constitutional.
So to your theory, every facial challenge is barred if the state can find some group of people, some party, some political group that likes the current system.
I think if it's furthering their associational interests, and we are not the ones that would have to find it because the burden is on my opponent to prove it does not exist. So
that's even worse.
Right, correct. Judge Seabright decided, and I think this was correct, and this court could take the same approach, that you needn't decide between the two facial challenge standards that are articulated in Washington State Grange. We've argued that under S.C. Myers, the court could apply Salerno, but strictly speaking, it's not necessary to decide that. You could decide either Salerno or the plainly legitimate sweep as an alternative. Judge Seabright decided it was facially constitutional under both.
Well, in terms of the second issue, and again, it's the question of whether they need to make a facial challenge, as applied challenge as opposed to a facial challenge. Tell me why Reed doesn't support your opponent's position.
For several reasons, Your Honor. I think the most important one is because Reed is inconsistent with subsequent cases from the United States Supreme Court, Washington State, Grange, and Crawford. And Bayless is the one that is consistent. So we would suggest that Washington State, Grange is the most important case.
Reed inconsistent, or does Reed just say this primary is materially indistinguishable?
Well, you're correct, Your Honor.
The one that was happened in Jones, and therefore, since nobody can distinguish it, we really don't need to worry about it.
You're correct, Your Honor. I jumped ahead. I was assuming you had gotten to the sentence where it says that the burden is inferred, which Judge Seabright, I think, correctly said is incorrect. Jones is, in fact, based on facts. So for Reed, yes, I think the most important thing is what you highlighted earlier.
It's not up to Judge Seabright to say Reed is incorrect, is it?
I'm sorry, Your Honor, I couldn't understand.
Judge Seabright said that Reed was incorrect.
Oh, no. He said he was persuaded by Bayless, which was consistent with later Supreme Court precedent. I believe that's consistent with, as he would.
That's different than saying Judge Seabright is Reed.
Correct. It's not at the end of the opinion.
In other words, I don't think that's that easy to discount Reed. I mean, just Reed is as much a law of the circuit as is Bayless.
True, Your Honor. However, if you look, the rule from Miller versus Gammy is that the intervening Supreme Court precedent would tell you which of the two. I don't disagree. Those central lines from Bayless and Reed are in conflict, but the Supreme Court has told you which of them is correct. So, because...
Well, but the Supreme Court never ruled Jones, and Reed relies directly on Jones. There's no Supreme Court case directly that, you know, to me infers that Reed is wrong.
I think the question, Your Honor, is not about the blanket primary, but about whether facts are needed to prove a severe burden on associational rights in a facial challenge. And in that, Washington State Grange says, yes, they are, because a facial challenge cannot be based on speculation. So that was a different kind of primary. It was Washington's top two and had to do with the proof of voter confusion. But
was the primary in Reed any different than the primary in Jones?
This court said no. This court said they were materially indistinguishable. So I think that's the most important thing, and the only situation in which facts would be unnecessary is if it met that requirement, Your Honor.
Can there be a facial? Is it your position that no primary system can be facially unconstitutional?
I would say as long as you can follow the standard for facial challenge and suppose rationally and reasonably that there are parties whose associational rights are furthered by whatever primary structure, then you're correct. All the primary systems could be hypothetically facially constitutional because all of them further someone's associational interests. I wanted to comment on one thing that Judge Hurwitz said earlier. You're correct about the Democratic Party's dominance in Hawaii. And my opponent is correct that we have no data about voter registration. And it is our assertion and something that is supported rationally by Hawaii's demographics that the people who vote in the Democratic primary are Democrats, whether they are registered with the party or not. So the party's assumption, and it is an assumption, that those individuals are acting counter to the interests of the party, they have no facts to back that up. There's only two facts in this record. The first is that the Democratic Party doesn't like the open primary. That's in Dante Carpenter's first declaration. It's a quote from the...
It's in the party's constitution.
It is in the constitution, yeah, the party's constitution, Your Honor. The second fact is about the party's membership as it existed in 2013, which is at the time showed that two-thirds of the party's members were people who joined in order to cast a ballot in the 2008 presidential fight between President Obama and Hillary Clinton.
And that's because your presidential primaries run differently.
That's correct. They're run by, it's called the presidential preference poll. It's run somewhat similar to a caucus run by the party, excepted from the open primary by statute, Your Honor.
Why is the state running primaries for political parties?
I believe that in general, states choose...
And I'm trying to find out what the state interest is in running a primary for a political party.
The case law shows that the state, as exercising the sovereign authority conferred for purposes of federal elections by the federal constitution and from the state constitution for state offices, is to put order and fairness into the democratic process. And that is the role that the states choose. And as to the choice to do it by democratic process, that is where the Supreme Court has said it's too plain for argument that the state may require.
The court said that, and I was trying to figure out. The court normally says that when it can't think of a reason.
that may be so, Your Honor. I believe that what it comes down to is whether the state has made the choice to make the democratic process more democratic. And I would say that the federal
constitution. Greater access to the primary process, for example, than the caucus process.
There's greater access, and it can be a little more in terms of the formality of how it's organized. But I don't think the federal constitution, in fact, I'm fairly certain, the federal constitution does not require the state of Hawaii to run a primary election. We wouldn't be violating the constitution if we said to the parties, go pick your own nominee.
My follow-up question was this. If you have an interest in running a primary system, what's your interest in the open primary system?
The interests are, as your honors have mentioned earlier before, which is those asserted in the 1978 Constitutional Convention in Hawaii. Switching from a closed to an open system was seen as a way, the most important interest, to reduce the chance of voter coercion, because it was felt, and your honor is correct, Judge Tallman, it had to do with the all-powerful sugarcane industry in that era, that you would be, correct, the old Hawaii, you would be stigmatized if you chose the wrong ballot at the party. Now, you can say old Hawaii, but 1978 is not that long ago. So that was their reasoning behind it. It's explicitly stated in the Constitutional Convention documents. We've also asserted that it removes barriers to voter participation, meaning the less steps there are between the voter and the ballot, the better it is, the more democratic the process is.
So is your argument that requiring people to formally register in the Democratic Party, formally join the Democratic Party, is a barrier to voter participation?
I think it's another step that's not proven to be necessary. Yeah, I mean, I think it's certainly within the state of Hawaii's discretion, as it is in every state's discretion, to decide what is more important to them. Is it more important to protect the vote from people who aren't eligible to vote, or is it more important to make it easy for everyone to vote? Right? Hawaii is quite clearly on the second side of that spectrum. So each state can make that decision for itself. It doesn't mean that every state must make the same decision, of course. Your Honor, I think I've hit the high points of the concerns I had today. I'd be happy to answer any more questions. Thank you very much.
The purported distinctions between the blanket primary in Jones and the open primary in Hawaii are essentially null, especially when you consider that one of the purported distinctions was that people have to join in order to associate with a party by some registration, which we don't have. So the blanket primary and the Hawaii open primary are the same in all material respects. We've put that in the brief. The other point.
What's your best case for a facial challenge to an open primary?
The case is that.
No, but that's the precedent. I'm sorry.
I think that we look to the analysis provided in Reed, and we look to the way Jones was actually decided, which is on the structure of the law and what the law permits to happen, not the pattern of random voter behavior, which can fluctuate year to year. A very thin reed, if you will, upon which to rest a constitutional determination. And I'd also like to say one other thing. One of the shadow arguments made about the difference between a blanket primary and an open primary is that people may be unwilling to cross over for a full slate, or there may be a difference between pick and choose. This is like the burglar who comes in to steal my jewelry and then discovers that while he's there, he might as well take the sports equipment, the china, and the silverware. That's the open primary. And I think that if you start thinking about what happens to down-ticket, non-charismatic races, the possibility of shifting, dilution, swamping, crossover is at least as great as with a blanket primary where someone can elect the charismatic race of choice and go back where it's comfortable. So please look at exactly how Jones was, in fact, decided, which the court in Reed did do. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. We'll go, counsel. The case just argued is submitted. We are adjourned for the day.